بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له إقرارا به وتوحيدا وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما مزيدا أما بعد. So as mentioned by the brother that today inshallah we are going, the title today is The Characteristics of the Servants of the Most Merciful. And this in essence is basically going through the Tafsīr of the end of Surah Al-Furqān. So I think the brothers are setting up some masahif over there. Or if somebody wants to follow the translation on their phones, then they can do also. It's Surah Al-Furqān, which is chapter number 25. And we are starting from ayah number 63. Surah Al-Furqān, chapter number 25, ayah number 63. We'll start with the recitation of these ayat, and then after that we'll go through the tafsir of them.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وعباد الرحمن الذين يمشون على الأرض هونا وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا وَالَّذِينَ يَبِيتُونَ لِرَبِّهِمْ سُجَّدًا وَقِيَامًا وَالَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا اصْرِفْ عَنَّا عَذَابَ جَهَنَّمَ إِنَّ عَذَابَهَا كَانَ غَرَامًا إنها ساءت مستقرا ومقاما والذين إذا أنفقوا لم يسرفوا ولم يقتروا وكان بين ذلك قواما والذين لا يدعون مع الله إلها آخر ولا يقتلون النفس التي حرم الله إلا بالحق ولا يزنون ومن يفعل ذلك يلقى أثاما يضاعف له العذاب يوم القيامة ويخلد فيه مهانا إلا من تاب وآمن وعمل عملا صالحا فأولئك يبدل الله سيئاتهم حسنات وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَفُورًا رَّحِيمًا وَمَنْ تَابَ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا فَإِنَّهُ يَتُوبُ إِلَى اللَّهِ مَتَابًا وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَشْهَدُونَ الزُّورَ وَإِذَا مَرُّوا بِاللَّغْوِ مَرُّوا كِرَامًا والذين إذا ذكروا بآيات ربهم لم يخروا عليها صما وعميانا والذين يقولون ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين وجعلنا للمتقين إماما أولئك يجزون الغرفة بما صبروا ويلقون فيها تحية وسلاما خالدين فيها حسنت مستقرا ومقاما قل ما يعبأ بكم ربي لولا دعاؤكم فقد كذبتم فسوف يكون لزاما.
جزاك الله خير. That was actually a very nice recitation. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you. So these ayat that you heard were ayat from the end of Surah Al-Furqān. And Surah Al-Furqān is a surah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he talks mainly about those mushrikeen, those who disbelieved in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes these people and talks about them, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts talking or ends the surah by talking about those people who are the opposite of them. The opposite of the mushrikun, the opposite of those who commit shirk, the opposite of those who disbelieve in Allah and His Messenger. And they are the servants of Ar-Rahman, the servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in this section, at the end of this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions a number of characteristics of those people who are from the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the slaves of the Most Merciful. Hence, these characteristics is very important for every Muslim to ponder over these characteristics and ask themselves, do we have these characteristics in ourselves? And are we truly from those who are the slaves of Allah or the slaves of Ar-Rahman, the Most Merciful, subhanahu wa ta'ala? And the reality is, each of these points, they are great points in of themselves, and each point can be made into a lecture. And I know, alhamdulillah, there are some students of knowledge and there are those that might not have studied, etc. Hence why the explanation, bi-ithnillah, will be at a middle level, bi-ithnillah. So not too hard, and at the same time, not too basic, bi-ithnillah. So in here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ in the first ayah. You want to start the first ayah with the translation? Arabic and English.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وعباد الرحمن الذين يمشون على الأرض هونا وإذا خاطبهم الجاهلون قالوا سلاما. And the servants of the Most Merciful are those who walk upon the earth easily, and when the ignorant address them harshly, they say words of peace.
Now, so this is the first ayah that is mentioned. The first thing we want to talk about before we actually mention the description or the different characteristics which are mentioned, the first we want to talk about the title itself, عباد الرحمن, the slaves of the Most Merciful. The first word in here is slave, a word which in English, you know, is the actual true meaning is lost. But عباد is from the word العبودية, servitude and worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this in reality is the best description that a Muslim could hold. Hence the Prophet ﷺ described himself with this description also. Such as the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ where he said, لا تطروني كما أطرت النصارى بن مريم. Do not lie about me and lift me up and make me onto a station which I am not. إنما أنا عبد. Verily I am a slave. فقولوا عبد الله ورسوله. So say that Muhammad is the servant of Allah and His Messenger. So this is from the greatest descriptions that a Muslim can describe himself with. And there are many ayat which talk about the importance of this. And then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says that these people are ibadur rahman, the slaves of the Most Merciful. And notice how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not say wa ibadur rabb, the slaves of the Lord, wa ibadullah, the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose His name, Ar-Rahman, the Most Merciful. So a person who ponders over the Qur'an asks himself now, why from all of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did Allah choose this name, Ar-Rahman, the Most Merciful? And inshallah, I'm going to mention 3 points that show the link between Ar-Rahman and what is mentioned here. The first is that it is from the mercy of Allah, Ar-Rahman meaning the Most Merciful. It is from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has made us from His slaves. This is a mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and a blessing which He has bestowed upon us. And secondly, when we worship Allah and we have servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is also from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because how many people are there that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created from mankind, and many of them do not actually worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So this worship that we do, this seeking knowledge that we may do, standing in night, reciting the Quran. This is from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, none of you will enter into Jannah with his own actions. So the Sahaba said, not even you, O Rasulullah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, not even me, except if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showers me with his virtue and with his mercy. Because this hidayah, this guidance, it's not from ourselves, it's not from our hard work. Rather, this is from the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third point is that when we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we hope for the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially on that day when we are stood in front of Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the name Ar-Rahman 3 times. So you can see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala links the servitude and His worship to His mercy. That without the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we wouldn't be from His slaves. Without His mercy subhanahu wa ta'ala, we wouldn't be able to worship Him. And through this worship, we hope for the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so great. And there's many ahadith in regards to it. From those ahadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created the creation, He wrote on top of His arsh, Inna rahmati taghlibu ghadabi. That verily my mercy overcomes and overtakes and overpowers my anger. I.e. the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is much more than His anger. And there's also another famous hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This hadith known as Al-Hadith Al-Musalsal Bil-Awwaliyah, which is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ar-Rahimuna Yarhamuhum Ar-Rahman. That those who have mercy, the most merciful has mercy upon them. Irhamu man fil ard. So have mercy upon those who are on this earth. Yarhamkum man fis sama. And the one in the heavens will have mercy upon you. And this hadith, I said it's known as al-hadith al-musalsal bil-awwaliyah. Al-musalsal, in mustalah al-hadith, is a special type of hadith. As al-Bayquni, he says, مُسَلْسَلٌ قُلْ مَا عَلَى وَصْفٍ أَتَى مِثْلُ أَمَا وَاللَّهِ أَنْبَانِ الْفَتَى كَذَاكَ قَدْ حَدَّثَنِيهِ قَائِمًا أَوْ بَعْدَ أَنْ حَدَّثَنِي تَبَسَّمًا. Musalsal is a hadith which has been narrated in a certain style. And then he gives a few examples. مِثْلُ أَمَا وَاللَّهِ أَنْبَانِ الْفَتَى. That this hadith has been narrated to me by a young person. كَذَاكَ قَدْ حَدَّثَنِيهِ قَائِمًا. Oh, this hadith, every single person who narrated it whilst they were standing. وَبَعْدَ أَنْ حَدَّثَنِي تَبَسَّمًا. Oh, this hadith, every single person who narrated it whilst they were smiling. So it's a hadith which has been narrated in a certain way. So this hadith is known as الحديث المسلسل بالأولية. الأول, what does أول mean? First. And what this hadith is that all the way, if you go back into the chain to Sufyan ibn Uyayna rahimahullah, when the ulama would teach, the first hadith they would give ijaza into their students would be this first hadith. So if you look at the chain, all of the ulama going back to Sufyan ibn Uyayna rahimahullah would say, وَهُوَ أَوَّلُ حَدِيثٍ سَمِعْتُ. That this is the first hadith I heard from my sheikh. And this is the first hadith I heard from my sheikh. And this is the first hadith I heard from my sheikh. And there's a whole chain of narration in regards to this hadith, and it's been preserved also. And I know we advertise that there's going to be a special surprise, and the surprise is that, alhamdulillah, today all of you, I'm going to give everybody who is attending today and listening right now, ijaza in this hadith also, for the brothers and sisters, and not for those who are watching online or the recording, for those who are attending. And this is a hadith which I got ijaza from Shaykh Damascus Qasim, the Imam of Al-Masjid Nabawi. And this is the first hadith that I heard from him. And this is the first hadith that he heard from his teacher, and so on, all the way to Sufyan ibn Uyayna, and Amr ibn Dinar, and Abi, and Al-Mawla Abdullah ibn Amr, and Abdullah ibn Amr, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَأَنَا كَذَلِكُ وَجِيزُكُمْ فِي هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ. And I also give all of you ijaza in this hadith. Those people who filled out the form from before, Bismillah, your ijazat after Salat Isha should be ready. And if anybody has not written their names, then there should be something sorted out for you guys to write your names after Salat Isha. Bismillah. And the same goes for the sisters. However, this hadith, this ijazah is not ijazah that, okay, you can teach, you're a sheikh. It's just an ijazah that you have heard this hadith. And this is from the sunnah of the ulama. Ibn Bārak in Muslim, in the Muqaddimah Muslim, he says, Al-Isnadu min ad-Din, that this isnad is from the religion. And it's something special only for this religion, amongst all of the religions. And in fact, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he says, it's not only for Islam, however, it's something special for Ahlul Sunnah. It's something special from Ahlul As-Sunnah. So, bi-iznillah, you will all get that ijazah with the whole isnad written, bi-iznillah, after the lecture, inshaAllah. So, this is in regards to Ibad al-Rahman, the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, the first characteristics Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, which is the ayah which the brother recited, is that the Ibad al-Rahman, the slaves of the Most Merciful, are those who have humbleness, those who are calm, and those who have humility to the Creator and to the creation. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَانِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنَا, that those who are walk, when they walk on the earth, they walk with humility. They don't walk with pride, with arrogance. Rather, they have humility. And also Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, when he commented on this ayah, he said, هَوْنَا أَيْ بِالطَّاعَةِ وَالْعَفَافِ وَالتَّوَاضُعِ, that what does it mean to walk with humility? I.e. obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and having chastity and having humility to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as Ibn Uthaymin rahimahullah mentions, that this walking with humbleness and humility is not something which is physical only. Not only which where a person when he's walking in a humble way, but also al-ma'nawi, a spiritual way of also having this humility. Hence the next part of the ayah, وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا, and when the foolish people, and what it means by juhal, what it means by ignorance here, not those that might not have knowledge, it means that those people who are foolish, those people that argue, those people, even if they have knowledge, they don't act upon that knowledge, they don't have the manners which that knowledge necessitates. وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا, they say peace. And this could mean even saying Assalamu alaikum, or the general, a more general meaning, salimuna min al-ithm. They say that which keeps them free and protected from falling into sin. Sometimes in a situation, somebody says something to you, and depending on the maslaha, sometimes being quiet is better, staying silent is better. But sometimes you have to say something. But when the slaves of the Most Merciful say something, they say that which keeps them free from falling into any sin. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, اِدَفَعْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنْ, respond or give back with that which is better. Somebody does something bad, you do something good. Somebody does something good, try to say even better than what they have said. And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a hadith, the Prophet ﷺ will make dua for this. The Prophet ﷺ would say, اِهْدِنِي لِأَحْسَنِي الْأَخْلَاقِ, O Allah, guide me to the best of manners. لَا يَهْدِي لِأَحْسَنِيهَا إِلَّا أَنْتِ, nobody guides to the best of manners except for you. وَصْرِفْ عَنِّي سَيِّئَهَا, and take me away from bad manners. لَا يَصْرِفُ سَيِّئَهَا إِلَّا أَنْتِ, nobody takes you away from the bad manners and takes me away from the bad manners except you. And this is something very important for a Muslim. Sometimes, unfortunately, you find non-Muslims are better than in certain manners. For example, if you go to a non-Muslim, a Muslim country sometimes, you go to a shop, you say something to a shopkeeper, he gets upset, he'll just kick you out of the shop. He don't need your money, he'll kick you out. Here, there's customer service, calm down sir, we'll get you a new pair. Sometimes you come to the masjid, practicing brothers, they won't give you salam, they'll have a frown on the face. Whereas the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, أَكْمَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِيمَانًا أَحْسَنُهُمْ خُلُوقًا, those people who are the most complete in their iman, who have the highest level of iman, are those who have the best of manners. Another hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, وَيْبَيْتٍ فِي أَعْلَى الْجَنَّةِ لِمُنْ حَسَّنَ خُلُوقًا, and there'll be a house in the highest level of Jannah for the one who has good manners. In another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, the Muslims, in their dealings with each other and with their love with each other, كَالْجَسَدِ الْوَاحِدِ, they are like one body. إِذَا اشْتَكَى مِنْهُ عُضُ تَدَاعَى لَهُ السَّائِرُ الْجَسَدِ بِالسَّهْرِ وَالْحُمَّى. If one part, one limb of the body feels pain, then the rest of the body starts swelling up and has an illness also. And that's how a believer, and that's how the servants of Ar-Rahman should be. This is the first characteristic of the slaves of Ar-Rahman. Now,
والذين يبيتون لربهم سجدا وقياما. And those who spend part of the night to their Lord prostrating and standing in prayer.
The next characteristic of the slaves of the Most Merciful is that they preserve their prayers, especially the night prayer. They preserve their prayers, especially the night prayer. وَالَّذِينَ يَبِيتُونَ يَرَبِّهِمْ, those who spend their nights. And the night doesn't mean the whole night. What's apparent from the ayah means the whole night. But as the sunnah has explained, the Prophet ﷺ would sleep half the night, then pray for a third and sleep again for a sixth. But they will spend a part of the night sujjadan wa qiyama, in sujood and standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned these two parts of the salah due to their greatness. Standing, because that's where you recite the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in prostration, because as the hadith, the Prophet says, أَقْرَبُ مَا يَكُونُ الْعَبْدُهُ مِنْ رَبِّي وَهُوَ سَاجِدٌ, the closest a person bees to his Lord is whilst he is in a state of prostration. And this is especially in the night prayer. Because as the Prophet ﷺ, he said, أَفْضَلُ الصَّلَاةِ بَعْدَ الْفَرَائِضِ وَبَعْدِ الْفَرِيضَةِ, the best salah, the best prayer after those prayers which are obligatory, صَلَاةُ اللَّيْلِ, the prayer at night. And in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, he says, عَلَيْكُمْ بِقِيَامِ اللَّيْلِ, upon you is to pray the night prayer, فَإِنَّهُ دَأْبُ الصَّالِحِينَ قَبْلَكُمْ, because verily this is the norm or the habit of the pious before you. وَهُوَ قُرْبَةٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكُمْ, and it is a means of you getting closer to your Lord. وَمَكْفَرَةٌ لِلسَّيِّئَاتِ, and a means of your sins being expiated and forgiven. وَمَنْهَاتٌ لِلْإِثْمِ, and a means of your sins being wiped out. So this is the second characteristic of those who are from the slaves of the Most Merciful. And if this is the case with the night prayer, a prayer which is not obligatory, then what about the case with those salawat which are obligatory? They have more precedence in this ayah than salatu al-layl, the night prayer. And that's why in hadith al-Qudsi, hadith number 38 from Arba'in al-Nawiyah, in hadith al-Qudsi, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ عَبْدِي بِشَيْنَ أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّ افْتَرَضْتُهُ عَلَيْهِ, that my slave does not come closer to me with anything except that which I have made obligatory upon him. That's how you get close to Allah, with those things which are obligatory. And then, وَلَا يَزَالُ عَبْدِي يَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ بِالنَّوَافِلِ حَتَّى أُحِبَّ, and then the slave, he carries on doing those things which are recommended, those nawafil, until he becomes from those that I love. But the first thing are those actions which are obligatory. Now,
والذين يقولون ربنا اصرف عنا عذاب جهنم إن عذابها كان غراما. And those who say, our Lord, avert us from the punishment of hell, indeed its punishment is ever adhering.
Next ayah.
إنها ساءت مستقرا ومقاما. Indeed, it is evil as a settlement and residence.
So the next characteristic, the third characteristics of the slaves of the Most Merciful, is that they are fearful. They have a fear of the hellfire. They have a fear of the hellfire, which causes them to stay away from that which will lead them into that direction. And in this ayah, they make this dua, وَالَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا اصْرِفْ عَنَّا عَذَابَ جَهْنَمَ, O Allah, take us far away from the the punishment of the hellfire. And notice how they use the word Rabbana. Rabbana, or translated, loosely translated in English as our Lord, or Rabbi, my Lord. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, when he explains what the meaning of the word Ar-Rab is, he says, Ar-Rab huwa al-Murabbi, al-Khaliq, al-Raziq, al-Nasir, al-Hadi. Five things. Al-Murabbi. The Rab, Lord, is a loose translation. The meaning of the word Rab is first al-Murabbi, the one who nurtures you. The one who nurtures you physically before you were born and allowing you to for the food to reach in the belly of your mothers. And then when you are born, he allows you to grow and he gives you strength, he gives you food. And so on until you grow. So this physical nurturing. And also the spiritual nurturing of Iman. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second, Al-Khaliq, the Creator. The Creator of everything, the Creator of you and I. The third, Ar-Raziq, the Provider, the one who provides sustenance. An-Nasir, the one who gives victory. And Al-Hadi, the one who guides. And then, Shaykh al-Islam, he says, وَهَذَا الْإِسْمِ أَحَقُّ الْإِسْمِ بِالْإِسْتِعَانَةِ وَالْمَسْأَلَةِ وَلِلْإِسْتِعَانَةِ وَالْمَسْأَلَةِ And this is why this name has the most right to be used when asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for help or for something. And this is why you will find that majority of the du'as of the prophets have the word Rabb in them. رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِنْ لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا till the end. رَبِّ هَبَلِي مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ And so many, the whole Quran is full with the du'as of the prophets with the word Rabbi or رَبَّنَا. So those who are from the slaves of the Most Merciful, they make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And from the du'as that they make, they do tawassul, they intercede with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala using his names and attributes. وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَدُعُوهُ بِهَا And for Allah, belongs to Allah, are the most beautiful and perfect of names. So make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with these names. So this third characteristic is that these slaves of the Most Merciful have this fear of Allah of the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hence why it's narrated on the authority of Aisha radiallahu anha that she asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam regarding this ayah. Or not this ayah, sorry. وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْتُونَ مَا آتَوا وَقُلُوبُهُمْ وَجِلَةٌ That those from the believers, their hearts will be trembling in fear. So Aisha radiallahu anha said, أَهُمُ الَّذِينَ يَشْرَبُونَ الْخَمْرَ وَيَسْرُقُونَ As these people who are fearing the punishment, as those who drink alcohol and those people that steal. And the Prophet ﷺ said, لا يا بنت الصديق, no. ولكنهم الذين يصومون ويصلون ويتصدقون. Rather, they are those who fast and those who pray and those who give sadaqah. وهم يخافون ألا تقبل منهم. But they fear that their good deeds and actions are not going to be accepted from them. Thus, Hassan al-Basri, he says, المؤمن جمع إحسانا وشفقة. A believer, he combines between doing the best action that he can. When he does an action, he does it to the best of his ability. But then after that, he makes sure he's careful from not nullifying that. He's scared that it might not be accepted. Whereas the munafiq, the hypocrite, جمع إساءة وأمنا. He's the one that does the action in the worst possible form that he can. And then he feels safe that, yeah, I've made it. And it's going to be accepted. ثُمَّ تَلَى الْحَسَنِ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ هُمْ مِنْ خَشْيَةِ رَبِّهِمْ مُشْفِقُونَ And then Hassan, rahimahullah, recited the ayah, Verily those who from the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are cautious and they are careful in their actions. And when we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us far away from the hellfire, that also includes any path that takes us towards that. Even if the action is halal, if it's going to take us towards that direction, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us far away from that. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will make the dua, Allahumma inni as'aluka al-jannah. Oh Allah, I ask you for al-jannah. وَمَا قَرَّبَ إِلَيْهَا مِنْ قَوْلٍ أَوْ عَمَلٍ And that which will take us close to it, whether it's a speech or action. وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنَ النَّارِ and I ask for refuge in you from the hellfire, وَمَا قَرَّبَ إِلَيْهَا مِنْ قَوْلٍ أَوْ عَمَلٍ. And anything which takes us close to that from speech or action. So this is the second, this is the third characteristics of the most merciful. Now.
وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا أَنفَقُوا لَمْ يُسْرِفُوا وَلَمْ يَقْتُرُوا وَكَانَ بَيْنَ ذَلِكَ قَوَامًا. And they are those who, when they spend, do not excessively or sparingly, but are ever between that justly moderate.
The fourth characteristics of the slaves of the Most Merciful is that when it comes to their spending, they are moderate. They are in the middle when it comes to spending. Instead of being on one extreme, which is being stingy, and on the other extreme, which is being extravagant and wasting money. Because this money is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is something which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask about you on the Day of Judgment. In the hadith of Prophet ﷺ, authenticated by Al-Albani, the Prophet ﷺ said that a person will not, his feet will not move on the Day of Judgment until he is asked about a number of things, and from those things, his wealth and how he spent it. So this is something which we will be asked about. And our money, are we extravagant? Are we going overboard? Are we wasting the money? We will be asked about that. Or are we being stingy? When we have to give zakah, we don't give the zakah, for example. When we have to spend on the family, we don't give them their rights. And that could be also wasting money as well, that you just spend everything on you, you spend on those things which you don't need, and you waste money. You will be asked about everything that you spend. And this is why Mutarraf ibn Abdullah, he says, خَيْرُ هَذِهِ الْأُمُورِ أَوْسَاطُهَا. The best of all of these affairs is that which is in the middle. That which is in the middle. So this is the fourth characteristics of the slaves of the Most Merciful. Yeah.
وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَدْعُونَ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَهًا آخَرٌ وَلَا يَقْتُلُونَ النَّفْسَ الَّتِي حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ وَلَا يَزْنُونَ وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ يَلْقَ أَثَامًا يُضَاعَفْ لَهُ الْعَذَابُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَيَخْلُدَ فِيهِ مُهَانًا. And those who do not invoke with Allah another deity or kill the soul which Allah has forbidden to be killed except by right, and do not commit unlawful sexual intercourse, and whoever should do that will meet a penalty. Multiplied for him is the punishment on the day of the resurrection, and he will abide therein humiliated.
The fifth characteristic of those who are from the slaves of the Most Merciful is that they stay far away from the major sins. They stay far away from the major sins. And in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned three of the greatest sins that a person could commit. The first, which is the greatest sin, which is shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hence by the Prophet ﷺ in the hadith where he mentioned the main major sins. The first one that he mentioned was a shirk. And in another hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, somebody asked him, أَيَّ ذَنْبِ أَعْظَمُ, which is the greatest sin? The Prophet ﷺ said, أَن تَجْعَلَ لِلَّهِ نِدًّا وَهُوَ خَلَقَكَ. To have a partner, to associate a partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, i.e. shirk, whilst he has created you. The second is killing a soul which is not lawful for a person to kill. And this is the greatest sin after committing shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the third is committing zina. And due to how harmful and the harms that zina has, that only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also made every single way which takes you as zina also unlawful and haram, from looking, from talking, and so on. So these are three sins that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned, and they are not restricted to these three. However, the slaves of the Most Merciful stay away from all of the major sins. An important qa'idah, principle, which should be mentioned, is that some of the ulama, they have said لا صغيرة لا كبيرة مع الاستغفار ولا صغيرة مع الاستمرار. There is no major sin if a person asks for forgiveness. As long as a person turns back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive him. And we'll come to the ayah shortly. وَلَا صَغِيرَةَ مَعَ الْإِسْتِمْرَارِ. And there's no such thing as a minor sin if a person is consistent upon this. Every day he's doing the same sin. And when he's, because there's no fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala left in that sin. So this becomes at the level of a major sin. Hence why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not only here mentions that the from the characteristics of the most of the slaves of the most merciful as those who stay away from major sins, but to give more emphasis, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says at the end of the ayah, وَمَن يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ يَلْقَ أَثَامًا. And those who do this, they will have a punishment. يُضَاعَفْ لَهُ الْعَذَابُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَيَخْلُدَ فِيهِ مُهَانًا. On the day of judgment, their punishment will be multiplied and they will stay in there forever. And when we mean staying there forever, we are talking about مطلق الدخول, لا الدخول المطلق. Those, obviously for those, the belief of Ahlul Sunnah in regards to the major sins is that a person, as long as he establishes Tawheed, if he commits the major sins, then he's under the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he may be punished in the hellfire. But if he is, eventually, bi-ithnillah, he will come out of the hellfire. But if he's a disbeliever, then he is staying in the hellfire forever. Now.
إلا من تاب وآمن وعمل عملا صالحا فأولئك يبدل الله سيئاتهم حسنات وكان الله غفورا رحيما. Except for those who repent, believe and do righteous work. For them Allah will replace their evil deeds with good. And ever is Allah forgiving and merciful.
Then this is a continuation from the previous, from the same point, which is that when they do, when the slaves of Ar-Rahman fall into mistakes, what they do is that they turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they follow that up with good deeds. And the conditions of tawbah are known. There are five conditions of a tawbah and a sixth in certain cases. The first is that if a person wants to repent, the five conditions. The first is that he repents sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not because he wants to show off. Not because he is scared that if he carries on that sin, the people will find out and that will be dishonor for him. But he does it sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second is that he stays, as soon as he wants to do that tawbah, he goes far away from that sin and from all of the means that take him to that sin. The third is that he regrets, true regret upon what he has done. The fourth is that he has a firm intention never to go back to that sin in the future. And number five, he makes this tawbah within the time a tawbah is accepted. And these are two. This is before the sun rises in the east and before a person's soul is extracted from their body. And then there's a sixth condition. And this is if this sin that you have done is connected with the rights of others. You've taken some money or whatever it may be, then a sixth condition which is added, that you give back the right to whom you have taken it from. Now.
وَمَنْ تَابَ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا فَإِنَّهُ يَتُوبُ إِلَى اللَّهِ مَتَابًا. And he who repents and does righteousness does indeed turn to Allah with an accepted repentance.
Now, that's just more information regarding what we have talked about now.
وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَشْهَدُونَ الزُّورَ وَإِذَا مَرُّوا بِاللَّغْوِ مَرُّوا كِرَامًا. And they are those who do not testify to falsehood, and when they pass in an ill speech, they pass by with dignity.
The sixth characteristic of those who are from the slaves of the Most Merciful is that they stay far away from those gatherings which not only have falsehood, but also those gatherings which have laghu, i.e. that speech which has no benefit at all. And this happens a lot even with practicing brothers. Sometimes you be in a gathering and you're talking for hours and hours and hours about something which has no benefit to you. Whereas those people who are from the slaves of Ar-Rahman, they spend that time in that which is beneficial. And those gatherings where there's no benefit, never mind those gatherings which have harm, then they stay away from those gatherings. So this includes all gatherings which has backbiting, lying, music, all of that. And also those gatherings where there are corrupt ideologies, the gatherings of Ahlul Bid'ah and so on. And also those gatherings where the celebrations of the the disbelievers are taking place. All types of gatherings where there is harm or that speech which has no benefit, the slaves of Ar-Rahman stay far away from this. And this is how a believer should, this is how shaitan, if he can't get you to commit the major sins or the minor sins, and it goes down and down, he tries to make you at least waste your time and not spend your time with that which is beneficial. So the slaves of Ar-Rahman, they do not stay far away from these type of gatherings. No.
والذين إذا ذكروا بآيات ربهم لم يخروا عليها صما وعميانا. And those who, when reminded of the verses of their Lord, do not fall upon them deaf and blind.
The seventh characteristic of the slaves of Ar-Rahman is that they venerate the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they accept it and it has an effect on them. وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِّرُوا بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِمْ Those who are reminded of the ayat, and this includes the ayat al-shar'iyya, the Islamic ayat, such as the Quran and the Revelation, and also the universal signs and ayat from the creation of the night and day, the sun and moon. The creation, when a person ponders over this creation, he realizes the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when he sees that the sun comes and goes and night and day comes and goes, likewise his life will come and it will go like nothing happened. And he just stayed عَشِيَّةً أَوْ ضُحَاهَا like an evening or an afternoon in this world. So those who are from the slaves of Ar-Rahman, when they, the signs of Allah, the ayat of Allah, the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes to them, they accept it and they venerate it and they allow it to have an effect on them. لَمْ يَخِرُّوا عَلَيْهَا صُمًّا وَعُمْيَانًا They do not act with these ayat when they are summan wa umyana, as they are blind, or as you know they can't speak. Rather, because these are the means of how things come into the heart. So just by a look, a shubha can come into the heart. Just by looking, that can cause some fitna. So that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned these two characteristics, summan wa umyana. The meaning being is that they listen with the presence of the heart to the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why Imam Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah in his book Al-Fawaid, on the first page, he said something on the lines, إِذَا أَرَدْتَ الْإِنْتِفَاعَ بِالْقُرْآنِ If you want to benefit from the Qur'an, فَاجْمَعْ قَلْبَكَ عِنْدَ تِلَاوَتِهِ وَالسَّمَاعِهِ Then gather your heart when you are listening to the Qur'an and when you are reciting the Qur'an. Don't make the Qur'an that when you are reciting, you're playing around, you're looking left and right, you're playing with your phone. And this is common, somebody is reciting and they're just doing this with their phone, for example. There's no presence of heart in that action. Rather, when you listen to the Qur'an, when you recite the Qur'an, you recite with your whole heart and your mind in that action. Naam. And there's a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrated in An-Nasa'i, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Inna abghadha al-kalami ila Allah an yaqula ar-rajul lir-rajul," that the most disliked speech to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is when a person says to another person, "Ittaqillah, fear Allah," fayaqul alayka nafsak, that don't worry about me, worry about yourself. This is the most hated and disliked speech to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whereas the slaves of Ar-Rahman, when they hear the commandments and prohibitions and the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they accept it.
والذين يقولون ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين وجعلنا للمتقين إماما.
And those who say, our Lord grant us from among our wives and offspring comfort to our eyes and make us an example for the righteous.
The eighth and last characteristic of the slaves of the Most Merciful is that they give a lot of importance to making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and having humility in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or not humility, they show that they are in need of Allah and they are feeble and insignificant in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And from the du'as is this du'a that is mentioned here. That after they have rectified themselves, they are also give a lot of importance to rectifying others. وَالَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا هَبَ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنَ. That, O Allah, grant us from our offsprings, our children, those who are the coolness of our eyes. And this encompasses many things. It's a general statement. It encompasses, make them the coolness of our eyes, because we will see them worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Make them the coolness of our eyes, because they will have birrul walidain. They will be good to their parents and uphold the rights of their parents. وَجَعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. And make us an imam for those who have taqwa. And we don't have time to go into at-taqwa. But make us an imam for these people, for those who have taqwa. And Shaykh Abdul Razak al-Badr, when he went through these ayat, he had a very profound statement. He said, لَا يَكُونُ الْمَرْءُ إِمَامًا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ بَعْدَهُ حَتَّى يَكُونَ مُؤْتَمِنًا بِالْمُتَّقِينَ قَبْلَهُ. A person cannot be an imam for the muttaqeen, for those who come after him, except by being a follower of the muttaqeen that came before him. By following the salaf, and following the actions, and the righteous, and the ulama that came after them. Hence why it's important for us to, you know, a lot of people shout salaf, salaf, salaf. Many of us don't know about them in reality. We know some of the names, we don't know anything about them. We don't know about their actions, we don't know about their biographies, we don't know about their worship. We might know that they refuted this person and that person, but, and that's all we'll focus on. We won't focus on, they used to pray 150 raka'at at night. We won't focus on how they would only speak with that which will benefit them. We won't focus on all of these other things. Rather, if we want to be an imam for the muttaqeen after us, we have to follow those from the muttaqeen who came before us. Now.
أولئك يجزون الغرفة بما صبروا أولئك يجزون الغرفة بما صبروا ويلقون فيها تحية وسلاما خالدين فيها حسنت مستقرا ومقاما قُلْ مَا يَعْبَأُ بِكُمْ رَبِّي لَوْلَا دُعَاؤُكُمْ فَقَدْ كَذَّبَتُمْ فَسَوْفَ يَكُونُ لِزَامًا.
Those will be awarded the chamber for what they patiently endured, and they will be received therein with greetings and words of peace, abiding eternally therein. Good is the settlement and residence. Say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, what would my Lord care for you if it were not for your supplication? For you disbelievers have denied, so your denial is going to be adherent.
And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala finishes off this surah after mentioning eight characteristics of the Most Merciful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the reward of his slaves. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, أولئك الذين يجزون الغرفة بما صبروا ويلقون فيها تحية وسلاما. That those people are going to be given rooms, i.e. in Al-Jannah. And there they will be receptioned with salam, peace from each other, from the angels. And they will have the best of reception in terms of speech and in terms of action. And one important point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بِمَا صَبَرُوا. They will get this reward due to their patience. So everything which we have mentioned, it comes back to patience. And this is from the most important things in the religion. Hence what Shaykh al-Islam says, فَمَنْ أُعْطِيَ اللَّهُ الصَّبْرَ وَالْيَقِينَ جَعَلَهُ اللَّهُ إِمَامًا فِي الدِّينَ. That whoever is given patience and certainty upon knowledge, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will making him an imam in the religion. Whoever has been given patience and certainty, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make him an imam in the religion. And we know that patience is of three types. You have patience upon the obedience of Allah. So those actions that we have, those good actions that we have, it's hard. Praying is hard. Sometimes it's hard. But we have patience upon that. And then, what time is that then? Okay, about 10 minutes. Okay, okay. The second type is that they have patience from the disobedience of Allah. Sometimes some sins, they come to them and it can be attractive. You know, you might want to look at something haram. You might want to listen to something haram. You just have a feeling shaitan is making you go towards that. But a believer has patience. And he knows that his patience for a few minutes here will be rewarded with eternity in Al-Jannah. And the third type of patience is having patience upon the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes things happen in life. Somebody passes away, you lose a job, you lose money, hardships come. But the believers, they know that this is from the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they are pleased with this. And they have patience upon this. And one point which I want to mention regarding the patience upon the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is also another three types. Having patience upon the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is also another three types. When you are doing an action, first you have to have patience before you do that action. How do you have patience before doing the action? Firstly, you have to learn how to do that action correctly. And that requires patience. And the second is that you have to have patience upon correcting your intention. In correcting your intention. Two people could be praying, but one person showing off and the other person is praying for Allah. One person is getting rewarded, the other person is falling into a shirk. And then, having patience during the action. During the action by acting upon your knowledge, and then also having patience upon praying that action or completing that action of obedience in the best possible manner that you can, with ihsan. And then you also have patience after doing the action. And this is where a person does not fall into anything which negates that action. Such as the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ where he said that there will be people who will come with mountains of good deeds. They pray, zakah, everything. But when they are alone with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then they transgress the boundaries of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, i.e. they fall into haram. And because of that, that nullifies the good deeds that they have done. And also having patience on having self-amazement after doing a certain action. There's a story of one of the Salaf. He went and he was with his son and a group of other people. So he went and they stopped at a certain place to rest in the night. So this person, I forgot his name, but this Salaf, he stood up and he started to pray Qiyam al-Layl. And he woke up his son and his son prayed with him. After they finished, his son turned around and he said, "Oh dad, look, alhamdulillah, we prayed and all of these people did not pray." So his father said to him, "It is better for you to stay sleeping and not pray than you to say this." Because he had this self-amazement. Look, I prayed and these people did not pray. So these are three types of patience upon the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Before the action, during the action, and after the action. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he finishes off the surah by mentioning the reward of those people who are from the servants of Ar-Rahman. So how great is this passage from in Surah Al-Furqan? How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he starts off by describing these people as the slaves and servants of the most merciful. And then he mentions a number of characteristics of these people before finally concluding and ending with mentioning their reward which they will get with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Al-Jannah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from Ibad al-Rahman. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us beneficial knowledge of the religion. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to act upon the knowledge that we have learnt. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين اللهم إنا نسألك الجنة وما قرب إليها من قول أو عمل ونعوذ بك من النار وما قرب إليها من قول أو عمل اللهم أصلح أحوال المسلمين في فلسطين اللهم أصلح أحوال المسلمين في فلسطين اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات وألف بين قلوبهم وأصلح ذات بينهم وانصرهم على عدوك وعدوهم اللهم لعن كفرة الذين يصدون عن سبيلك ويكذبون رسلك ويقاتلون أولياءك اللهم خالف بين كلمتهم وزلزل أقدامهم وأنزل بهم بأسك الذي لا ترده عن القوم المجرمين سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك